Judge Fields will have to be the first in line to answer here. The Commissioner's Court, over which you will preside, if elected, develops and implements the county budget and supervises county's employees. What financial and personnel management experience do you possess for performing such duties?
And I'm going first, is that right?
Yes.
Well, I have 11 years of experience of presiding over Commissioner's Court. I also have an MBA in business, a bachelor's degree in finance. I like to look at things from a business perspective, and really, if you analyze county government, it's a service industry. The counties don't produce a good, they don't provide a product, they provide a service. And like a lot of service industries, we're payroll heavy. But here's what we provide. We provide a court system. We provide over 700 miles of county road and bridge system. We provide emergency management. We provide a budget that we think is appropriate to allow the other elected officials to do their duty properly as mandated by the state of Texas. Thank you.
Mr. King.
Yes, so I have been the mayor of Cisco for 4.5 years up until just recently. Before that, I was a patrol sergeant for the Cisco Police Department. I was a judge supervising employees in the courthouse. In the police department, I supervised several employees. And in the military, I was constantly in charge of supervising employees. Employee supervision is not an issue. Finance is a big problem, though. Not for me personally. I've developed budgets in conjunction with city managers. With the city of Cisco, there was a time when we didn't have a city manager in the city of Cisco, and I had to coordinate the budget or do the budget myself with the finance director there and present that to the city council. I've constantly been very involved. In fact, our city managers sometimes think I'm too involved in the budget process for Cisco, and I'm very concerned with the current budget that the county has. Our current budget has about an $850,000 hole in it, drawing from funds left over from previous years to balance the budget, to balance the current budget, because current expenditures are greater than current incomes. And so one of the reasons I'm running is to try to fix that, get our budget back on course. Sometimes the employees view me as a little bit, I guess, tight with the purse strings. That's not a bad thing for the voter's perspective. Sometimes it's a bad thing from the employee's perspective, but I hope that the employees appreciate my efforts as well in that, because in the end, we're all taxpayers, and none of us can afford to waste money at any government level. Cisco underwent some budget struggles over the last couple of years, and I was one of the chief people calling for fiscal restraint and drawing down on the city's budget. I hope to do the same with the county level, and so I'd appreciate the opportunity to do so.
Sure. The Commissioner's Court, over which you will preside if elected, develops and implements the county budget and supervises the county's employees. What financial and personnel management experience do you possess for performing those duties?
Okay. I pretty much covered a little bit of that in my opening statement. I have had 8 years of dealing with the private sector, which is different from the public sector. I have been over multiple departments, having to deal with hiring, firing, demoting. You have to have a certain personality in a lot of ways to be able to deal with different people and different aspects of the job, because not every job and person is alike. Like for instance, with my zero-based budget, I actually have had experience doing that. Eastland County currently, we have a recurrent budget that is basically, it's the same budget. It's the same budget from last year, and you take it and you move it forward, and you either reduce it or you decrease it. Reduce it or you increase it. With zero-based budgeting, you're going to start at zero. And like I said, I've actually done that in the private sector. And a lot of times you can go in and you can find things that are obsolete, things that have been in the budget for 10 years that are no longer needed, as well as you can find things that inadvertent waste that is going on that nobody realizes, because technically we're all taxpayers, so it's our money. And like I said, I've had a lot of dealings with a lot of different areas with payroll and different aspects of life, and all the way from truck stop employees to salesmen, just a vast array. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Llewellyn?
Thank you. As far as the response to that question, I think probably the main thing that I have that would benefit in being a county judge in regards to the budget and dealing with commissioner's court is my 28 years experience as an attorney. Like I said, 26 of that was running my own office. I've dealt with supervising several employees, also managing my budget for the law office. As an attorney, I deal with several different people. I deal with clients, I deal with judges, I deal with probation officers, court personnel, and you've got to get along with all those people to try to get everything to work. Bottom line is, there's only so much money that the county has, and there's a lot of things that money is earmarked for by both the state and federal government. They mandate it. Certain things be taken care of, and the county's responsible out of their own budget for taking care of that. And that's everything from the courthouse personnel, with the exception of the district judge and some other employees that are paid by state. But the courthouse, the jail, indigent defense, there's a whole lot of things that the county is responsible for. But there's only so much money to go around. I think my experience, I would be able to sit down with the various officials in the county and emergency personnel, things like that, and try to work out put the money where it needs to go. And I think that would be my strong points in that area.
Thank you. And I remind each of you that each of you has a 1 minute additional time for response if there's something you want to do before moving to the next question. So just be mindful of that. Okay, question number two. This will be answered first by Mr. King. The county budget has steadily increased over the last 5 years while county population has actually shown a decrease. What is your assessment of the county government's financial practices?
Yeah, as I said, this is one of the areas in which is one of my chief concerns. Actually, the county budget has basically tripled in 15 years, doubled roughly in the last 10 years. And I've got a problem with that as a taxpayer. The county has not grown, as you've noted. In recent years, we may have declined. I look forward to seeing the next census as it comes around to see exactly what's going on with our population. But the county has steadily grown as far as the county government. And if you don't grow the population, but you grow the government, I'm wondering what's going on. There's no not a larger populace to serve. There's there may be even smaller, but the budget is exploding, and I don't see a reason for it. I know that a lot of times county officials, because I was one, they get comfortable. As Teresa has said, you get comfortable in your budget and you never look at ways to reduce it. Nobody ever wants to reduce, to relieve or return that money back to the central government at the end of the year. That's always a problem that you have in every office. And it's a problem that Judge Fields and the Commissioner's Court has to deal with, because they're not directly spending this money. It's the every elected official that's over every office is in charge of their personnel and their budget, and they submit requests to the county, to the Commissioner's Court, but essentially they don't ask permission to spend those dollars. And they certainly don't want to turn that money back at the end of the year whenever they're looking at redoing the budget for the next fiscal year. And I know very few county officials have been in the practice of doing that. Typically, that's where at the end of the year you see what money you've got left and see what kind of things you can buy, maybe to stock up for the next year, maybe a bunch of supplies that you need. I've personally seen a bunch of supplies bought for the next year that ended up being wasted because things changed in the next year where you didn't use all these supplies anymore. And so we had just stacks of things just laying around that we had to get rid of because they weren't, they were bought with good intentions to supply for the next year, but ended up not being used. So I really think that we need to take a hard look, and I'm offering a fresh perspective to do that at our current practices and see if we can't draw back a little.
Thank you. Hey, Ms. Slaughter.
I'm sorry, Gary, could you repeat the question?
Yes. The county budget has steadily increased over the last 5 years, while county population has actually shown a decrease. What is your assessment of the county government's financial practices?
Okay. Like I said, that's another one of those where the zero base budget will come in. I want to see, and I'm very passionate about seeing Eastland County grow and prosper. We need to bring in more industry. We need to bring in more people. Your population is decreasing. You know, the taxes, everybody's mentioned the taxes continually go up. Therefore, everybody's having to pay more because there's less to go around. Like Margaret Thatcher said, eventually you're going to run out of other people's money. So, I mean, I'm fully for we need to get in there. We need to look at all the different aspects of the budget. We need to slim down where we need to. But another part, it's not just the one part. We've got to grow. We've got to economically grow. It goes hand in hand.
Once again, this kind of goes back to the answer to my last question. This isn't just a county problem. The cost of county government has went up statewide. All counties are facing the problem. But we're in Eastland County, and that's what we need to be concerned with. The problem that I mentioned before is there's so many areas that the state and federal government mandates that a county do certain things, and they're responsible for footing the bill. I touched on a few of them: the judicial system, indigent health care, indigent defense attorney's fees. Those fall over into CPS cases. We're seeing more and more in Eastland County, I know, because I get appointed on a bunch of these cases, I see a lot. We're having more and more CPS cases where CPS is coming in and taking kids from parents. Those parents, if they can't afford an attorney, are entitled to a court-appointed attorney by statute or by a mandate, the county has to pay for that. Training for jail staff. There's certain mandated training that the sheriff's department has to make sure that their employees go through. So there's a lot of things that the government says the county has to do. And that's one of them areas where we're going to have to look at and sit down with all the different departments and try to allocate the money. Also, look, I think it's important to look into any kind of funding that possibly we may not be utilizing and getting from the state or federal government. But once again, it's a complex issue, and it's just going to take rolling up sleeves and making it a county effort and not an individual department. I think that's what I can bring to the table.
Judge Cleveland.
Thank you. Well, I'm not sure where we have heard that the population has gone down. It's actually gone up a little bit in the 2000 population census. Between that and the 2010 population census, it went up about 300 people, which is basically a wash. It hasn't gone down any. I-20 now, instead of 18,000 cars every 24 hours, we're now up to 22,000 to 25,000 cars, vehicles. And you wonder, how does that have an impact on county government? Well, it does, because we have to provide services, which would be like law enforcement, jail, emergency management. We've increased the amount of money that we pay to the fire departments. The jail alone is a substantial amount of our budget. In fact, the jail alone is probably the largest portion of our budget. I've got some numbers here from 2008 to 2018. The jail expenses have gone up about 54% in those 10 years. And that increase is due to what the state tells us we have to do. Sheriff Bradford, who's sitting back here in the back, does an excellent job, he and his staff, in maintaining a 97-bed jail to the highest degree possible. We hardly ever get Dean from the jail commission that tells us we've got to do something. We supply the jail what they need, but the state tells us we've got to do more. We've got to do more. Do you know what the state pays to the county for jail? Nothing. And yet we have to hold sometimes a prison-ready inmate for days, if not weeks, while they try to find a bed for the prison. That's just one idea of an unfunded mandate that we get sent down. There's also indigent health care. The state says, and this is my best example of an unfunded mandate, the state says we will allocate 8% of our general revenue tax levy for indigent health care for somebody that qualifies. And that is somebody that lives in Eastland County but lives outside the hospital district. We only have one hospital district in the county, East Memorial. So if you qualify, you will get indigent health care. Also, if you're in jail, you qualify for indigent health care. Indigent health care costs in that same period, 2008 to 2018, have gone up 211%. County government is not cheap. Any kind of operation is not cheap. As Mr. Wallen indicated, we also have to have indigent defense. Judge Harrod and I put together an indigent defense plan each year, every 2 years. We have to file that with the state. We use the federal poverty guidelines. That has gone up about 40%. And he's right. We do have to do a lot more attorney ad litem appointments for CPS cases. The state mandates that we do that. That's part of what's happening in the budget. Another part that's happening in the budget that people don't realize, from 2007, we had an enormous flood. If you live in Lake Leon, you will remember that. In 2015, we had another enormous flood. 2016, we had another enormous flood. What that does to us, thank you, is hurt our budget because of the money coming in and the money going out. It makes the budget look out of whack. Thank you.
Richard, if I may. Yes. 1 minute. I do agree totally that there are a lot of things that the state tells us we have to do. I don't have an issue with any of the candidates saying that. And that's one of the problems that we've got. A lot of the mandates that the state puts on us, they don't help us fund, or they put in a little bit, like $25,000, and then the bill comes in at the end of the year, $250,000. county has to put in to pay for this program that the state has mandated. However, there are other issues that we can do. I'm going to point out one department that is a new department. It's a department that is not in every county. It's our joint election administrator. And the department was funded as a consortium with the cities and the county, and the county or the different entities pay in $5,500 a year for participating in that, but we get about $45,000. The county gets about $45,000 in funding for that. However, they're spending $244,000 a year in that program. And that's a program that's not strictly necessary, because that is actually a function that was under the county clerk before that. We chose to go to this program, and we went from paper ballots to electronic ballots, thinking everything would be easier, everything cheaper. Everything does not turn out to be easier and cheaper in the long run. We just paid $300,000 for election equipment. And
thank you, Mr. Keene.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Ms. Lauder?
I'd like to add something to that as well. Unfunded mandates has been, and it has been brought up on numerous occasions. I have a very close working relationship with our state representative and our state senator. And I haven't learned everything I need to know about it, but I have gone into some discussion with them. They know that it's a problem, and they are willing to work, and I'm willing to work to go to Austin as well to see if we can alleviate some of those, because that is a huge issue.
Thank you. Judge Beals?
I have my 1 minute rebuttal.
Yes, sir.
Mr. King has mentioned the election equipment and the Joint Election Administration. Federal law requires that all counties use electronic voting machines. It's a federal law. They helped us with the HAVA grant. It's called the Help America Vote Act. They helped us buy machines. They bought machines for us. That actually was started before I came into office. Those machines were a little bit clunky. They worked okay for a long time, but they were getting close to the end of their life. We were able to negotiate a trade-in of those machines. We got about $100,000 in trade-in on those 40-something machines. We traded them in. We bought new voting machines. And if you voted in the last constitutional election, they were much, much better to eat, much easier to work with, much more user-friendly. As a matter of fact, that is the only debt that the county has. About $174,000 is what we owe for those machines. That's it. We don't owe for trucks, we don't owe for SO vehicles, we don't owe for road graders, we don't owe anything except for those 40 or 50 new voting machines. Thank you.